Good afternoon, students. So I am Dr. Ronak, and I will be teaching you about sterilizing disinfection. It's one of the very important chapters regarding the general bacteriology. So starting with the definitions, sterilization is a process and used to render a product, which may be a surface, article, or a medium, free from all forms of viable microorganisms, whether these are bacterial endospores or vegetative forms. So more than 6 log CFU reduction of most of the resistant spores, if happens, then we term the process as sterilization. In case of disinfection, a process that eliminates virtually all recognizable pathological organisms except bacterial spores. Here the bacterial spores are not killed, only the vegetative forms are destroyed. So here the definition is more than log 3 CFU reduction of microorganisms except spores. We are not bothering about the spores here. And lastly is antisepsis. It is the process of disinfection on living tissue or skin, whereas disinfection per se can happen on inanimate objects and on animate bodies. If it is done on living skin or tissue, that is called antisepsis. So order of resistance. Firstly, the most resistant organism is prions, which are misfolded proteins, followed by the Cryptosporidium oocyst, followed by bacterial spores, Mycobacterium, other parasitic cysts like Giardia cyst, Entamoeba cyst, cyst of your parasites, mostly protozoa, then small non-enveloped viruses like your polio virus, norovirus, these small type gastroenteric viruses, they comes under small non-enveloped. These are the most hardy viruses to be killed among the spectrum of viruses. This is followed by the trophozoite of parasite like Giardia, trophozoite of Entamoeba, etc. Then comes the gram-negative bacteria, followed by fungus, then large non-enveloped viruses like rotavirus, then comes gram-positive, and lastly, the most weakest of them is the enveloped viruses like your HIV, coronavirus, etc. Now we come to the different methods of sterilization disinfection. So methods are physical methods and chemical methods. In physical methods, we have 3 basic classifications. One is heat, second is filtration, third is radiation. In case of heat, we have 2 types of heat, whether it is by dry heat or by moist heat. Mostly in case of dry heat, the process is charring, coagulation, and denaturation of the proteins and nucleic acids. So the methods in dry heat are incineration, flaming, as you all know that we flame the loop before doing the culture, so that is flaming, and last is a hot air oven, which we'll discuss in the following slides. Then we come to moist heat. Moist heat is basically regarding the latent heat that steam or moist air transfers to the surface of the object. So that's latent heat is transferred to the organisms, and that heat transfer of heat causes coagulation of protein and the destruction of the microorganism. So we have 3 classification depending on the temperature, final temperature at which we are doing the process. If it is below 100 degrees, then we have pasteurization, which is done mostly in case of milk, then inspiration, vaccine bath, or we can do it at 100 degrees centigrade. So you can do boiling, or we can do steaming by Koch and Arnold steamer. And more than 100 degrees centigrade, the most important method is autoclaving, which we'll also discuss in later slides. Second method is filtration. As you all know, it is a separation of the microorganism from the solution. Mostly it is done for serum and other heat liable medias. And last is radiation. There are 2 types, ionization and non-ionization. Firstly coming to hot air oven. So it is a method, as I have already discussed, it is dry heat sterilization method. So we keep the articles and heat at 160 degree centigrade, and we keep it for 2 hours. So at 160 degree centigrade, we keep the articles for 2 hours. That is the whole temperature and timeline. What are the articles we sterilize with this process? Mostly the glassware, syringes, glass syringes, metal instruments, the sharp metal instruments, cotton swabs, and all types of oils. That is glycerin, paraffin, and the powders. Like your powder, that the dusting powder which is used in case of gloves is also sterilized by this process. In this case, for every method, we have a biological control indicator which is employed in the method. If it comes negative, then the process is running well. So here we use spores of Bacillus subtilis, subspecies Niger. So if the spore grows and you have a growth, by a visible growth after the process, then it means the spores are not killed. So the process is not maintained. So there is a failure in the sterilization. If you get a sterile plate, sterile culture plate, after you have done the process from the spores, so the spores have been destroyed and the biology control was okay, and the process was satisfactory. Second is inspiration. Inspiration is a method of moist heat exposure method. Here we use below 100 degree, that is 80 to 85 degree for 30 minutes for 3 consecutive days. So what it happens, on the first day you kill all the vegetative forms and you allow the spores to germinate. On the next day, the germinated spores of the first day will be killed by the same process of heating at 80 to 85 degree for 30 minutes. So this process continues for 3 days, after which most of the spores have germinated and their corresponding vegetative bodies have been destroyed by this process. This doesn't kill the spores, but it causes the spores to germinate into the vegetative body, and then we are killing. So ultimately we are making the media sterile. So it is employed in high protein materials. It causes setting of the material by coagulation, and secondly it kills the organism. So in egg and serum containing media which cannot withstand very high temperature, which causes degradation of the protein, are sterilized by this method, like Lowenstein-Jensen media used for TB culture and Loeffler serum slurry used for diphtheria culture. It causes protein coagulation without altering its chemical properties. That's why it is used in this method and these medias. Lastly, moist heat. We will discuss the most important method used for sterilization in hospitals as well as in our department, is autoclaving. The autoclave is a piece of instrument used for sterilization of various requirements in the laboratory, and the method we use is wet sterilization or moist heat sterilization. So water is heated in a closed chamber and the saturated steam is produced under pressure. So according to Boyle's law, if you increase the pressure, the boiling temperature, the temperature at which water boils also rises up. So with increasing temperature, we are increasing the boiling point of the water. So at 15 pounds per inch square, LBS per inch square pressure, the water boiling point rises 121 degree centigrade. At this, if we keep the articles for 15 to 20 minutes, then due to moist heat coagulation of protein, most of the organism including spores are destroyed. So it causes sterilization of the articles. So hot saturated steam penetrates rapidly and it gives up the latent heat, which condenses, and due to the transfer of this latent heat, the pathogens, proteins and other structures in the pathogen are coagulated and the ultimately cause the destruction of the pathogens. Now, indicators of autoclave. So there are various physical and chemical as well as biological indicators. first indicator is the pressure. So the pressure must be at 15 lbs per inch square. Then the time should be maintained from the point it has reached the temperature and the required pressure. After we start the calculating the time, it should be 15 minutes time and the temperature should be 121 degree centigrade. Then in case of chemical, we have heat sensitive autoclave tapes, which we will discuss in later slides, which gives idea whether temperature has reached or not. And this is not an indicator of sterilization, but it indicates whether the substance or the article which you have kept has been the heat has reached a substance or not. Lastly, the most important indicator or control is the biological indicator, where you use spores of Geobacillus stereothermophilus, which is a thermophile. So we have small vials having the spores. If they grow after 48 hours after doing the autoclave at 60 degree centigrade, we incubate them. If there is growth, so there is failure of the autoclave of that day. So we have to discard and do the autoclaving again with a new set of controls. So this is a picture of an autoclave where you can see the pressure gauge, you have safety valve, and you have the metal jacket around it. Inside there is a carrier where you put the water, sufficient amount of water, and put the articles. Articles should be placed in such a way that the steam can pass through the various articles. They should not be jammed together, and this can cause a negative pressure area inside where the steam may not reach and you may not have the required sterilization in that central area. Then you come to the second method, physical method, is radiation. Radiation are of two types. One is ionization radiation, example gamma radiation, and non-ionization radiation. Most commonly we use the UV rays. Third is a filtration. We use different type of filters, mostly are gravity filters or membrane filters like candle filters, asbestos filters, etc. Sterilization by radiation. The mechanism is it damages the nucleic acid, leading to breakage of the rDNA. It destroys all types of vegetative cells, eukaryote, prokaryote, viruses, as well as the bacterial spores. So two types I have already discussed, and the biological control we use is spores of Bacillus tumulus. Now ionization radiation. Ionization radiation, most commonly gamma rays. So the source is cobalt-60, which is a radioactive isotope. So sterilization is used for disposable plastic and rubber supplies, like mostly the single-use syringes. We normally use disposable syringes, catheters, infusion sets, bone and tissue grafts, the sutures, Kattgat sutures, and the sutures, and some antibiotics and hormones are also, which are heat sensitive, are also sterilized by radiation. Advantage is it has a very high penetrative power, action is rapid, the time required is less, and it is a cold method, temperature is not required. So coming to gamma radiation, the most common radiation method we use, physical method of sterilization. It is a form of electromagnetic radiation, very short wavelength, and causes ionization energy. So quick turnaround time, easily penetrates the packaging, and ideal for many heat liable materials. So used are hypodermic needles, IV set, air tubes, catheters, drainage bags, ECG electrodes, disposable ECG electrodes, implants like hip, knee, etc., and various instruments. So this is the chamber gamma ray sterilization machine. This is the cobalt-60 source, and this is also the machine where you are entering all the gloves, packets of the single-use gloves. Non-ionization radiation. So use the ultraviolet radiation. It is mostly lethal to microorganisms, and it mainly causes disinfection in closed, clean surfaces. It has less penetrative power. That's why you need a clean surface. Most commonly used in our department are the biosafety cabinets, where we do the regular cultures, and it creates a sterile environment after every exposure of UV radiation for designated time period and a designated dose. Disadvantage is it can damage the eye and skin if there is a direct contact, and it doesn't penetrate the darts or proteinaceous materials and glass. So it is bactericidal and virucidal. The main source is mercury vapor lamps. Action is it acts on nucleic acid, causes pyrimidine dimers, thus renders the pathogens dead. Recommended dose is 250 to 300 nanometer wavelength for 30 minutes. Limitation is a low energy level, it is poor penetrative power compared to gamma rays, and can disinfect only clean surface and particle suspended, and limited working life of the lamp is also an issue. It is used to disinfect the internal surface of cabinets, OTs, entranceways, labs, etc. Now we come to the third method, that is filtration. So there are two types. There is gravity mediated depth filtration, and another is the membrane filtration. In depth filtration, we use fibrous or granular material bonded into a thick layer that removes mostly the organism due to their pore size by physical skinning or entrapment. So earlier we used a glazed porcelain, the Chamberlain filters, cotton plugs, asbestos like Sieve filter, etc. Nowadays we use the membrane filters, which are porous membrane mostly made of cellulose acetate, nitrocellulose, cellulose polycarbonate, etc. Pore size can be of three types. One is 0.22, another common one is 0.45, and rarely we may use 0.8 micrometer. They are used for all the pharmaceutical and heat sensitive solution like culture media, vaccines, ophthalmic solution, filtration of air by surgical mask, etc. Biological control which is used are Brevinomonas, Demonata, and Serratia marcescens, because they are very small in size. Then we come to another type of filter, this high efficiency particulate filter or HEPA filter, which you recently have known due to COVID-19 pandemic. The purpose of HEPA is to catch small particles and remove from air that passes through 99.97 particles having a size of 0.3 micron. Now the construction of filter, it involves a filter material that is glass fiber or similar type of material. It is pleated into various layers so that the pore size decreases, and the pleated material is glued together in a frame. So you can see the diagram here. This is a basic construction of HEPA filter. Now we come to the chemical methods. So in chemical method, we have the most commonly the disinfectants. So accordingly, there are three levels of disinfectants: the high level disinfectants, intermediate level disinfectants, and the low level disinfectants. High level disinfectants include glutathione, hypochlorite. Intermediate level disinfectant include phenolics and alcohol, and low level disinfectants include the quaternary ammonium compounds and aniline dyes. So the spectrum of organism which is killed by high level are most of the organism except large number of spores. Intermediate, mostly organism except spores, and low level is mostly vegetative bacteria, envelope viruses except mycobacteria. Coming to one of the highest level of disinfectant, also known as sterilium, that is ethylene oxide. It doesn't need the heat. That is also, it is called cold sterilization method. It is flammable liquid gas and highly explosive. That's why to render it non-explosive, we have to mix with carbon dioxide or CFC, chlorofluorocarbon, 10%. Highly penetrative, and it kills most of the spores and microbes. That's why it is a sterilant. And it diffuses into porous material, dissolving into rubber, plastic, silicone, and it is freely soluble in water and oils. Again, the action is It alkalizes amino carboxyl and hydroxyl as well as sulfhydryl groups in protein, rendering them non-functional, and also reacts with DNA and RNA by degrading them. It is used to mostly sterilize heat liable articles. And limitation is articles that cannot be used immediately because there is a desorption time. You cannot do the process and use that immediately. You need to keep it some time so that the ethylene oxide is desorbed and released out. It is highly mutagenic, teratogenic, and carcinogenic. That's why its use has been decreased a lot. Test organism in this case, biological indicator is Bacillus atrophius. Second is all the aldehydes. So most common aldehyde which is used nowadays in our labs and the hospital setting is glutathione. The high level, it is a high level disinfectant, chemical sterilant. Mode of action is alkylation of sulfhydryl, hydroxyl and carbonyl groups and causing RNA, DNA protein alteration. Most commonly it is used in the form of 2% aqueous solution, also commercially known as Cydex. So all the scopes, dialyzer, transducers, anesthesia equipments, hemodialysis equipments, everything, laparoscopic trochers, etc. are sterilized by this method. And it is non-corrosive to metals and does not damage the lens instrument. That's why it is mostly preferred in case of all the scopes. Formaldehyde is used as a disinfectant and a sterilant in both liquid and gaseous states, used as a water-based solution, which is we call as formalin, that's 37% weight by volume formaldehyde, is bactericidal, mycobactericidal, tuberculocidal, fungicidal, virucidal, and also sporicidal. So it kills most of the microorganisms along with spores. It inactivates a microorganism by alkylating amino and sulfhydryl groups in mostly the purine bases, but it causes production of irritating fumes and pungent odor. Earlier, it was used to prepare vaccines, viral vaccine like polio and influenza for inactivation. It is also used as embalming agent and anatomical to preserve anatomical specimen. The most recent of these aldehydes is ortho-phthaldehyde. Ortho-phthaldehyde is a high-level disinfectant. It can kill up to the spores. Same as the other aldehyde mechanism action. And it impairs the membrane function also, allowing the biocide to enter the penetrable membrane. It interacts with intercellular reactive molecules like RNA and DNA and degrades them. Advantage is it doesn't require activation like glutathione. It is non-irritant and it is very stable at room temperature. Now we come to the chlorine-based methods like hypochlorite. Hypochlorite are high-level disinfectants. They are mostly bactericidal, sporicidal, virucidal, and less active for mycobacteria. The mechanism action is oxidizing agent. They also causes free radical production and causing destruction of the pathogens. They inactivate the organic material. They are corrosive to metals and textiles. They are mostly used for disinfection of water, sanitation, general disinfection and of surfaces and spills. So in case of spillage, you use 1%, that is 10,000 ppm. The whatever we get in the market is either 4% or 5%, that is 50,000 or 40,000 ppm. So we have to dilute it to 1% for spillage. For discard jars of bacteriological labs and virological labs, any lab, we use 5,000, that is 0.5%. And for cleaning surface and other equipment, we use 1000 ppm or 0.01%. Then we come to phenols. They are intermediate level disinfectants. Most commonly are like cresol, chloroxylenol, like which is Dettol, and Lysol. So they cause plasma membrane. They interact with the plasma membrane like peptides, and inactivate enzymes and denature protein. They are bactericidal, microbactericidal, and little activity against spores and viruses. they are active in presence of organic matter. So in case of organic matter, you can use the phenolic compounds. So generally use they are generally used disinfectants for surfaces for like 2% concentration. Then we come to the alcohols. Mostly we use nowadays as alcoholic rubs like ethyl alcohol or isopropyl alcohol. 70 to 90% is the requirement, and is intermediate level disinfectant. Susceptible organism, bacteria and lyophilic virus, mostly the envelope viruses. And resistance are non-envelope viruses, spores, mycobacteria, etc. Mode of action is they coagulate or precipitate the protein. They have poor action in presence of organic material and should not be used. That's why in case of organic material, you should go for a proper soap and water hand wash. They are used as skin disinfectant, antiseptic lotion, and cleaning of surface devices, benches, etc., where you cannot use the hypochlorite or phenolic compounds. Then you have the bigonite, like chlorhexidine, most commonly used. They are low level disinfectant. We use at a 2 to 4%. 4% is used to kill the C. difficile organism. And the mode of action is you form salt with inorganic organic acid and thus killing the organism. They are used for skin disinfectant as well as they can be, they are used in as mouthwash, gargles, etc. Then we come to the iodines and iodophores. Iodophores are combination of iodine and an agent, complex agent carrier molecule. It what it happens, it causes, it doesn't give the color of iodine. So it doesn't cause coloration of the article. The best known is the povidine iodine, also known as betadine. So it penetrates the cell surface quickly and leads to disruption of protein and nucleic acid structure. It is bactericidal, mycobactericidal, virucidal, but it needs a very long contact time to kill fungi and spores. So it is not very much useful for spores and fungus. It is an antiseptic, most commonly used in surgery, and also disinfects medical equipment like hydrotherapy tanks, thermometers, endoscopes, etc. Last is a low-level disinfectant, that is quaternary ammonium compounds like benzalkonium chloride, cetylpyridium chloride, etc. They are mostly cationic detergents. They have a strong activity against gram-positive rather than gram-negative, and they are fungicidal, virucidal, and amoebicidal. They do not have any activity for mycobacterium tuberculosis or the spores. Next is a new type of sterilizer or method of sterilization using hydrogen peroxide, that is plasma sterilizer, where reactive mixture of ions, electrons, and neutral free radicals are produced at a very high temperature in a very high electric and magnetic field. We also know that plasma is the fourth state of matter. So when you heat gas at a very high temperature with magnetic and electric field around them, it causes production of this breakage of the molecular structure, the atomic structure, leading to formation of these ions, electrons, photons, and neutral species. So this mixture is called the plasma. So in plasma state, the vapor breakdowns and forms plasma cloud, which inactivates and kills all the microorganisms along with spores, and it used to kill heat stable as well as heat sensitive, because it doesn't it is cold type, though it needs temperature to produce the plasma, but it can be used for heat sensitive or articles also. Biological indicator is same as that of autoclave, that is geobacillus, stereofamibilis spores. Now come to the indicators of sterilization. So for testing of adequacy of sterilization, we use the biological indicator as autoclave. In case of autoclave, we use geobacillus stereothermophilus spores. Hot air open, we use bacillus subtilis subspecies Niger spores. Gamma radiation, we use bacillus tumulus spores. For ETO, we use bacillus atrophius. For filtration, we use brevendumonas and serratia. Chemical, we use either heat or chemical sensitive dyes like bovidic tape strips and Brownie's tube. So these are bovidic tape strips. You can see if all the markings are there, even all the markings have come, that means it is a satisfactory test. So temperature has reached the level which is required. If it has missing marking, that means it is not a satisfactory test. So the method has failed. This is a Brownian tube indicator where you can see various colorations of the tube according to which we see whether it is the sterilization process is satisfactory or not. These are all chemical and heat indicators. They don't effectively tell the effect that autoclaving was done, the proper autoclaving has been done. They are indicators of the conditions. Biological indicator like this pores test is a indicator of the whole process. So you can see here in the left right side, this is a spore test having a indicator that is bromocresol purple. So it is the original color. If there is no change in the color, that means the spores have been killed. So the media has not, there is no growth of organism which doesn't cause the breakdown of the glucose leading to production of acid. So this has not happened. So there is no change in the color of the indicator. So no growth. So the test has passed. If there is growth after 48 hours at 60 degrees centigrade, as I already mentioned, so there is production of acid for breakdown of the glucose and it causes decrease in pH leading to the change of color from bromocresol purple indicator from purple to yellow. So the change in color as well as turbidity indicates that the autoclave has failed. Another is a test for effective adequacy of disinfectants, that is called in-use test. Here what you use, we take 1 ml of disinfectant and transfer it to 9 ml of the media, that is nutrient broth, and then we mix it, and from that mixture, 10 ml mixture, we place 0.2 ml drops, 5 drops, 10 drops in 2 plates. And you can see the 10 drops in 2 plates. One plate we incubate at 37 degree for 3 days. Another we incubate at our room temperature around 22 degree at 7 days. If there is more than 5 colonies on either of the plate, any one plate having more than 5 colonies or more than 5 spots showing growth, then we discard it. There is a failure of disinfection. Now there is a classification of 1968, Spalding classification, which classifies which are critical instruments, which are semi-critical instruments, which are non-critical instruments, according to which we designate which type of sterilant or disinfectant should be used for those. The critical instruments are those which enter normal sterile tissues or vascular system or through blood flow. Where there is sterile fluid is passing, like blood, synovial fluid, pleural fluid, etc. Then semi-critical are those which touch the mucous membrane or skin that is not intact, and non-critical are which only touches the intact skin, like thermometer. So objects of critical, you need sterility, so you kill all the microorganisms including spores. So all surgical instrument devices, cardiac catheters, implants comes under critical objects, and you need either ETO or hydrogen peroxide or chemical sterilization with 2% glutaraldehyde or phthalaldehyde, etc., which kills all the organism along with spores. Next we come to the processing of semi-critical organism objects. So we free all the organism except high number of bacterial spores. We cannot do away with high number of bacterial spores. So all vegetative forms are killed. So level, so use like respiratory therapy, anesthesia, all the scopes, whatever we use, these are high level. So we need a high level disinfection. So semi-critical objects need a high level disinfection, mostly the scopes. Third is a non-critical patient care things. We can be expected to be contaminated with some organism, so kill most of the organism, fungi and the envelope viruses like bedpan, bed railing, EKG leads, thermometer, bedside table, floor, furniture, etc. So So we can use a low level disinfectant here. Now something about the COVID-19 disinfection guidelines. For surface disinfection, we use chlorine or chlorine based compounds, most commonly sodium hypochlorite 0.1% solution for surface disinfection. WHO recommends at 0.5%, that is equivalent to 5000 ppm for disinfecting surfaces. We can use hydrogen peroxide of 0.5% to accelerate. It causes, kills in 1 minute and a very good biocidal activity. Quaternary ammonium compounds, CDC recommends for disinfecting medical instruments which come in contact with intact skin because they are not harmful to the skin rather than chlorine and chlorine based compounds. Disinfection for hand and skin disinfectant, we use normally for hand hygiene for alcoholic rubs like ethyl alcohol, isopropyl alcohol. So use a formulation containing around 70 to 90%, depending on various brands, as inactivate SARS-CoV-2 because they are enveloped viruses. We can use iodoforce 7.5% povidone iodine as a surgical rub or soap containing povidone iodine for hand washing. For skin, we can use 0.5% iodine based disinfectant or hydrogen peroxide. For mucous membrane, we can use 0.05% iodine based disinfectant. So for floor, the criteria is the contact time. There are two things. You have to have the adequate concentration and also the contact time. These are the two main important things for a disinfection of an article or an area. 1% hypochlorite for 10 minutes. You can use 3 hourly or when there is spillage or when there is required. High touch surfaces, metallic, non-metallic, we can use alcohols or hypochlorite depending on the nature of the material. 10 minutes, similarly 2 to 3 hours. Low touch surfaces like walls, ceilings, etc. Same 1% hypochlorite, 10 minutes, but the frequency it may be twice a week because they are not touched regularly. The biomedical waste bags, outer surface, 1% hypochlorite, 10 minutes before discarding each time. Articles like ECG probes, USG machine, pulse oximeter, which comes into regular touch and changes in patient, we need 70% alcohol wipes. The contact time is till it dries. It has to be applied adequately so that the whole surface, it covers the whole surface. And it should be used till the alcohol completely dries. After each use, as frequent as 2 to 2 hours should be repeated. Clinical sample containers, mostly outer surface, 1% hypochlorite, 10 minutes before sending to lab. Discarded linens, 1% hypochlorite, they should be have a contact time of higher, that is 30 minutes, mostly soil before discarding the linens. So this is all about sterilization disinfection. Earlier in the physical classes, we used to take you to the CSSD facility where these processes and all these things are seen practically. You could see, but since we cannot do a physical class, we have to take virtually about the theoretical part. If then later date we can have a revision class, take you to the whole facility and show all the in physical form. Thank you very much.